And our first speaker is Sebastian Rohde. He has studied chemistry at the Ludwig Maximilian University, and he then switched to biophysics for his PhD, where he was working on the software and hardware components of imaging systems. And then he joined Zeiss 9 years ago, where he is currently active as a product owner for the integration of machine learning in microscopy solutions. Yeah. So I met Sebastian a couple of months back. Christoph Stock and I, we were thinking we could pitch to Zeiss a neural network that we trained in order to analyze microscopy images. And Sebastian really turned the tables on us. At the end of this presentation, I think Christoph and I, we were even more flashed after Sebastian had showed us what Zeiss had already met in place when it comes to operationalizing machine learning models. So I hope you're as thrilled as I am for this presentation, and please welcome Sebastian.
Hello, also from my side, and obviously thanks for inviting me and the kind introduction. And I try to make up for some of the time we lost in the beginning, but I hope you can still enjoy it. So the talk will be about what I call the open ecosystem for integrated machine learning workflows. And it's basically, I will try to tell a story like, how did we start at Zeiss, and how did we basically try to align all the requirements from industry and academia towards having a machine learning solution for our various platforms. And to start, sorry. So basically one slide as an introduction to what company or what kind of company we are. So mainly is we are a portfolio company. So we have various different areas that have to do with microscopy, with measurement technology, with semiconductor stuff. Obviously, probably most famous with microscopy. We have the digital innovation partners, which is probably pretty close. Toward what you typically do, and have some requirements towards using machine learning solution. The area where I mainly work is digital solutions, software development, and microscopy. So there's an overlap. Nevertheless, most of the stuff we do is used all over the company. But later on, I will mainly refer to solutions that are used in digital solutions, microscopy, and in software development. And as Sven already mentioned, so actually, I always say I'm a microscopist by heart, because I started off as building imaging systems that integrated some software. And over the years, I would say now the main component of imaging systems has become software. Okay, let's move on to the next slide. So here, this is one example of a machine learning solution at Zeiss that I want to talk about. It's called Sample Finder. Short remark, can I hide this? Does somebody know? Let's see. So AI Sample Finder, as the name already tells, it's artificial intelligence sample finding. So what does it do? Basically, this is using machine learning for ease of use. And it's just a very, I would say, interesting example to watch. And it's basically about you put the sample on your microscope, press a button and you wait, and then it's ready to acquire images. And I think without explaining it in detail in words, I try to go to the next slide and you can see the video. So here, that is a typical scientist putting on a sample on that microscope. This button says find sample, and now all the AI is starting and you don't see it. It's doing in the background. Here, okay, some images are taken from the sample with a fancy LED. And here, this is where the AI starts, basically checking this image and first figuring out what kind of sample carrier is it. Is it a slide, a petri dish, a well plate? It's automatically detecting what you are interested in. And it's even automatically converting this into an experiment. So the only thing you have to do at the very end, basically start acquire an image. All the work, like looking for a sample, finding it, focusing it, is done by some AI in the background. And what the next slides will be all about is, how do we create such solutions? What tools do we need? What kind of like rough guidelines do we use? What is our overall strategy? This is one of the solutions we created. There are a couple of more. That would be cool. I just keep talking. So to give you an overview, where do we use actually machine learning in microscopy? I made that slide. And basically, our main application in microscopy obviously has to do with image analysis and image processing. And there are, I would say, three main areas: classification, segmentation, processing. And those kinds of things are, I would say, 90% of what our customers use AI for when it comes to microscopy. There are some additional examples, but what I will focus on later on is an example from the world of segmentation. But as you see, we use it also for finding the sample, classifying objects, detecting defects, and also for some really processing stuff, like removing noise from images or improving the resolution of images. This is all done by AI solutions to some level. It's not completely AI, obviously, but to a certain degree. And most importantly, I would say, for microscopy is probably the segmentation stuff. I jump over here. Okay, so let's dive into some details. So what are typical requirements for machine learning solutions at size? Because as you imagine, we have customers from industry, like really automotive, whatsoever, pharma, but also hardcore academia scientists, which probably know more about machine learning than we do. But they all use the same kind of microscopes and want the same kind of AI-based solutions. So one of our hardest tasks is how to align those different requirements. And basically, I try to summarize our very basic considerations here. So obviously, as probably all of you know, this artificial intelligence heavily relies on open source frameworks like TensorFlow, PyTorch, those kinds of things. So, and here actually at ZEISS, we also use them. There's no point in inventing this on your own. One additional thing that is pretty tricky: academia wants to be flexible and they hate to be locked in. So any kind of black box solution is to a large degree not an option for them. Sometimes there are even rules in place that you have to say, I use that algorithm, please show me the source code if I ask for it, which is not the case in industry typically. If it works, it works, and then they are happy. And obviously, what is also important for us in academia, there are a lot of free open source tools which reach a high level of, I would say, maturity. Some of them have the same level of, I would say, performance than commercial tools, but they are, so to say, for free. Obviously, they are paid by our tax money, but for the end customer, for free. So this is also something we have to consider, because in the very end, as a company, you have to make money with what you do at some point. And last but not least, as I said, industry, it's a little bit different. They want some streamlined stuff, ideally one button. If it works, it works. And if it saves some money and time, it's fine. What algorithm is used is not so much of interest as long as it works. If it doesn't work, then they jump up, obviously. So important criteria to summarize for us are: we need flexibility because of academia and the broad variety of topics and microscope systems we have. It must be easy to maintain. This is very important for us because we have big software platforms that are maintained over years. And you all know this problem, like with legacy code and so on and so forth. So we need to create something that is maintainable. So no hacky solutions are an option for us. Easy to use, and easy to use means easy to use for the end customer, but also for our developers, in the sense of, if programmer A does something, also programmer B should be able to reuse this code. So not doing everything twice is super important for us. Yeah, performance is important because we have really large data set in some cases. So gigabytes up to terabytes are more the rule than the exceptions. Customers expect us to work on Windows and Unix systems to some degree. And then there are customers that have this kind of like server processing stuff in mind. So not everything will take place on the desktop in our world. And then obviously the science community likes Python and MATLAB and those kinds of things. You need interfaces for that. So, and last but not least, as I said, in academia, you have to basically make transparent algorithms so that you can prove that it works. So, and as you can see here, this is, I would say, a broad range of requirements which are not so easy to put into one solution. And basically, here we decided very early on, let's use open source tools wherever we can. TensorFlow, Onyx, Python, all those stuff. Obviously, you have to check if it's secure, so on and so forth. So we have a lot of mechanisms in place to do that. Nevertheless, this makes sense from our perspective. And we rather decided, let's focus on ease of use and the service around those machine learning solutions, the data handling, and the integration in the other tools. This is why it's called Open Ecosystem for Integrated Machine Learning Workflows. We also learned, at least in our area, that the latest, greatest algorithm is not always the best choice. You need something robust, easy to understand, sell it to 8 out of 10 customers, which are happy. The 2 super experts do their own stuff anyway. That's my personal experience. So let's come back now to our example with segmentation. So what is a typical problem statement? I try to summarize here some of the statements we use. It's basically segmentation and image analysis are the biggest challenges, because at the very bottom you see it, the actual purpose of an image is to be analyzed. And image analysis requires segmentation. If you can't segment it, you can't analyze it, you can't extract numbers from it, and then you can't get information. So if segmentation does not work, then you are screwed, so to say. This is why segmentation is a big challenge, and here machine learning and AI can be super helpful. So this is what we have as our problem statement, and now how do we approach it? And here now a little bit jumping a bit forward, but there is not one segmentation problem in microscopy, but a lot. And then there are industry customers, academia customers, some want service, some want openness, everybody wants something, but we cannot create a special solution for everybody. So, and our approach here is actually like outlined here. So we have our desktop solution where you can train machine learning models. Not the most fancy ones, but typically they do the job. That's straightforward. Okay, if you do this, then you have something that we call always a trained model to do image segmentation. But there are other ways to create those trained models that reflect those broad requirements from industry and academia. So what we also have is a cloud-based processing platform called Appear. So www.appear.com if you're interested. I think the link comes at the very end as well. This is a cloud-based platform that allows you to annotate images and train more fancy or more complicated neural networks using cloud-based processing resources. So you don't need a big machine locally, you do it in the cloud. And if the training is done, obviously you download your network and you import it into your desktop solution. Or you just stay on the cloud and use it there. This is, I would say, your personal choice. I will come to that later in more detail. And especially for academia, we also said it must be possible that you train your own network, because we use TensorFlow or Onyx or PyTorch. So why not allowing any data scientist to train a model and basically package it into something that can be used in our software? So basically train something, do whatever you like. If you want to use it in our nice, or hopefully nice software, this is where you have to obviously then pay. But training a model that works for our software is free for everybody. This is our approach. And most importantly, I would say for industry, in some areas, they have no experts in image analysis and deep learning, but they still want a solution. And here we say, okay, if you don't have the experts, we can do the training for you. It's a service that costs money, including the labeling, because that can be the tedious part, like drawing a lot of blobs or whatever, rectangles. We offer that as a service. We have something called special customer solutions teams that talk to the customers and say, okay, this network costs you, I don't know, 2 weeks of work and it has a price tag. at the very end, whatever you do, you have a trained model that will end up in our Zen software. This is our Zen Blue software. And here you see an example of a stack from an electron microscope. I think it's a brain from a fruit fly, like a really tiny, obviously, subset. This is the result of the segmentation by a deep neural network. And all the other normal methods did fail here. So how do we implement this in one ecosystem without, and this is important, driving everybody in R&D crazy? Because this then would be me and obviously the developers. And what components and tools do we need for that? So in the end, it's about like effectively implementing such a solution without like making super big expensive projects and creating a lot of code that nobody can reuse. So, and important to understand obviously is the recognition of this process. Typically in machine learning, it's about training a model, the green box, and using a model. Those are two separate things. And this is also a little bit where we separated our solution. We have the cloud platform to do the training. Yes, you can also do the analysis there, but and then the desktop solution where you probably do the final analysis, or you train it in the cloud and then you use it at a company where they are not allowed to connect to the internet for whatever reasons. So this is a bit, in our world, very important that there is the possibility and sometimes the demand to split the training from using it later on. And then, as I mentioned, we, over the years, learned some important, I would say, hard lessons, but this turned out to be probably the most important one when it comes to the solutions. Really, it's worth investing the time reusing code that somebody else wrote. Even if every machine learning or data scientist has a lot of fun developing their own stuff, in the long run, budget-wise, project-wise, it's not really the way to go, in my opinion. This is also important. Use and define open standard formats. I come to that in a second when it comes to our model format and our data format, because you are really tightly connected to the open source community and there it makes sense. This I mentioned, so I'm jump over it. Open source tools are important. This is crucial. I think it goes together with reusing. If you don't allow your developers to really document stuff because the next feature complete is close, you will pay the price just half a year later. This is sometimes a little bit hard to convince our managers that less features and more documentation is actually the better way to go, but okay, it's about the balance. And here, this turned out to be important, especially for our cloud platform, but also now for our desktop solutions. Stuff like cloud and container technologies like Docker can be an important component because you can avoid this dependency hell, what I call it, and encapsulate stuff and make it scalable and shippable. And last but not least, algorithms are nice, but for the end customer, the usability of a solution is at least as important, especially in industry. Academia, they are sometimes used to so crazy systems that everything is intuitive for them. So now I will talk a bit about the components. As I mentioned, standard formats. So, and here we made a decision at ZEISS. Let's not create our own fancy own model format, but just let's use TensorFlow, as I said, or Onyx, and create really an open source tool, a package called CSIM model, which is free to use for everybody. So we put it on the Python package in this. Some of you might know it. This allows you to package your own trained model with some metadata so it can be used in our software solutions. We use it also internally because it has model versioning and metadata. Everybody can use it. We are not charging for it. And as you see here, so pip installs this model, all you have to do. I always say it's the glue between our different tools. This is the idea. Because we have not only the Zen platform, we have our cloud solution, we have the Arrivis software, we have Deep Vision and other stuff. My job is to convince everybody use CSET model. So this is actually an internal product and it starts to work better and better. It took a bit, but now most people see it makes sense. And this is important for academia. As mentioned, it opens our ecosystem up to academia, because everybody can use it. And here's just an example. I think I won't spend much time here. If you go to the CSET model page, you get a Jupyter notebook or a Colab notebook. You can try it out with your own machine learning code and maybe then get a trial license from our Zen software and see if it works, if you are interested. So then there is more stuff, which I will cover on the next slides. And probably to save some time, I think I will fast forward here. There's another important thing that we learned. It makes sense to also have Python packages that are not completely open source, but what we call internal source. So basically, this is where we develop Prisma Learn. It's basically a computer vision library for machine learning that is deployed as a Python package inside Zeiss that allows various machine learning workflows. And the idea is every project team doing machine learning can take stuff out and use it. And if they have something really cool, also contribute. So it's actively developed over time, not put everything in, but really the useful stuff and the fancy stuff you keep on your own. Otherwise it would get too big. But this concept of using internal source really makes sense from my opinion. In the end, it pays into this making it reusable. Yes, you need some rules and guidance. You cannot really hack in stuff without writing tests and so on and so forth. So you need some support from the software architects that say, no, please write tests as well. But if you are a little bit strict in the beginning, it works nicely. And this toolbox offers those kinds of different workflows. So you can do classification, segmentation, denoising, and it has those things like data factories and quality metrics and all those stuff. Because as I said, if every data scientist has so much fun reinventing everything, this will end up in a mess from my experience. I know this because I also have fun doing this stuff. And if nobody stops me, then I have something that only works for me. But this, the main point here is having internal sources distributed as Python packages works really nicely for us. Maybe we will make it open source one day as well. It's up to us. So, but as I said, how do we now do it on the desktop for microscopy? Because most end users have a microscope and a workstation and maybe a second workstation, but kind of still typical desktop solutions. And you cannot easily say, oh, we have cloud processing. That doesn't really help directly. You need tools to connect those worlds. And just as to give you an impression how desktop solution, what do I mean? So basically here you see two flavors of the same solution. It's called IntelliSys segmentation. This would be a typical user interface to train a simple machine learning model in our Zen software. And here you see the results. And that is, here you see kind of the same thing. This is a life science example, so living cells. I think this is some alloy. I'm not an expert here. That's our industry style software. It looks a bit more, you know, nice and streamlined. But below, it's the same code. This is important. So our concept is using the same, so to say, machine learning backends and putting a customer focused user interface on top. For academia, a bit more flexible. I mean, here it looks also very, very simple, but the software is more flexible. This one is more workflow oriented and streamlined, but obviously they use the same machine learning tools. So this is what I mean with desktop solutions. And behind the scenes, keep in mind that it's important to reuse all those Python stuff. And here our approach is we have desktop solution, which is in our world typically a .NET application. And we have this machine learning stuff. And our way to go is keep this clearly separated, not mixing it together. So if you have an image here that needs to be segmented by a neural network, this one here never sees the full image. It has no idea if it's a gigabyte or a terabyte. We cut it into tiny pieces, send it over, in this case, REST APIs to our Python service. So it's a remote processing service that can be run on your local system, but also on servers. And then you do the processing, and here you get the images back to your desktop solution. And for the customer, he doesn't see what's going on. You press a button, you have to wait a bit, depending on the size of your image. But this is what we try to be pretty strict. Separate those Python processing service from our desktop software in order to make it reusable. So standardized interfaces and standard formats are crucial. Yeah, okay, this slide is also just an example. What we also find out works really nice as an appetizer, especially offer pre-trained models for customers. So they have some typical solutions, problems, and then we say, okay, in this case, cell nucleus detection. That's why I call it nucleus detector. This is a bit the life science thing, but here we trained our own unit because a lot of customers say, I have heard about units. They are really cool. Do you have it? If you have a pre-trained network, then you start talking. And typically they do a pretty good job if they are pre-trained to detect cell nuclei. And then in the next step, maybe you retrain it with customer specific data. This is an important learning. Pre-trained models can help to make people accept your solution because then you can immediately show it works. If you say you need to train for one day first, and then you might see a result, this is not so feasible in some situations. So how do we train it? This is probably the most tricky part. And what about the cloud processing now? How does it work together? So and here we have this Appear ML, which is part of our cloud processing platform Appear. And here you see the website. So this is really running in your browser. Here are some additional information, Chrome, Firefox, whatsoever. The main concept here is you don't need to install anything on your local machine. You just need an account, log in, and then upload your data, do your labeling, press the training button, and wait a bit. You get an email when training is done. Then you download the network, and then you use it for image analysis. It's free. Try it out. So this is what it looks like. Has a hopefully intuitive and nicely designed web page. It's changing quite frequently. I think there is a new release every 2 weeks or so. But basically, it's about annotation, training, and checking out the results. And here, this would be our annotation tool. This is what it looks. Here you see those cell nuclei that you label. And on the next slide, here you see how the labeling process for microscopy typically looks. So this is what you have to do. And depending on your actual problem, you have to do a lot of those labels. You can easily spend 1 week, 2 weeks, or even more. This is why it makes sense to offer it as a service for industry, because they don't have that time typically. Nevertheless, in the recent weeks, we came up with a new concept for labeling called partial annotation, where you only label a few objects and the background around it. So you don't have to label the complete image anymore. That saves a lot of time and seems to be really nice. But this is what I mean with labeling. Like malen nach Zahlen, what I always say to my kids. And sometimes if they are bored, I sometimes say, oh, you can label some cells for me. And sometimes they do it. Yeah, and in the end, if you have all the labels done here, you see this button, start new training. This is basically all you do. So our goal was make it usable for the non-experts. So no scripting needed, no tuning of any fancy deep learning parameters. This is all done internally. So that means we are not will not win the contest of the best network of all times, but it's super simple to use. Everybody can use it. And this is, as I said, our goal, make 8 out of 10 people happy and not the super expert. And this seems to work now. Behind the scenes, it's all running on Azure and yeah, basically utilizing a bunch or daisy chain of Docker containers. At the end, you get an email with some results that you might or might not be able to interpret, especially when it comes to those metrics, but you have to have those. Also for us, if a customer says, oh, it doesn't work, we need a measure, see if the training made sense. And obviously most important for the ecosystem in the end, this button, download CSIP model. So this is where it will be packaged, or it is already packaged into that standard format, and then can be downloaded. Yeah, and now here this, don't worry about the details. This is actually what is behind Appear. To make it short, because we don't have so much time, it's a cloud-based processing platform that has a web interface. The main concept is use Docker container together with a specification for the UI. So you have a Docker container that contains the code. You have a JSON file for the UI. This is all rendered in the web interface, and the Docker containers can be daisy chained to what we call workflows. So a workflow could be you start the first Docker container that does some kind of processing. Then there is an output of that one. That is the input for the next one, and so on and so forth, which is all done by Kubernetes. And the main idea here is allow creating workflows to use basically the code you like. Because every module is its own Docker container. What is inside doesn't really matter. It's all about the well-defined inputs and outputs. Most of the containers I've seen use Python. Yes, that's probably the most popular language for machine learning especially, but I've seen Java, C++. You could also create containers that already contain complete applications that then run, so to say, in the headless mode. That is what behind our Pure Cloud platform. I'll jump over that one. It's basically the same thing here because I want to emphasize why we actually did it. So what are the benefit of such a platform? So, and one main reasoning was we have a powerful software solution. For microscopy, it's Xen, but whatever we do, it will never be enough. There will be always somebody saying, can't you add function X? Because this is important for me, especially in academia. And as probably most of you know, to add a function into a big software just for one person, it's not really worth the effort. But integrating a Docker container that encapsulates that function with a nice user interface into your software is a totally different game because your main software will not get more complex. This was our main idea in order to avoid the maintenance hell and reduce code complexity. It's really, also at least for what I do, one of the main drivers. And obviously it's faster. Putting a little bit of Python code into a Docker container, it's not so complicated, especially not if you do it more than once. The first time is the hardest, but there are on a peer nice tutorials and examples which you can download. And I think Sven already tried it and you can ask him for an independent opinion. I would say most, especially data sciences, for those it's simple. So, and at the very end, obviously it's about our desktop software, having some kind of extra software that communicates to the web platform. And obviously we need to install Docker locally, but if you now are in Xen, you can basically browse all the modules on our platform. So basically you can choose from a collection of ready to use containers. You download them to your local machine and then run it from Xen. So basically, again, it's about separating the concerns. So Xen, our main desktop software, doesn't know about Docker. It just has input and outputs. Yeah, okay, those are the technical details. Benefit of Docker is you can also install the Docker not only on your local desktop, but also on a server in the basement. And this is where it comes to the scalable processing. Because where you run the Docker, our desktop solution doesn't care. You just have to understand, okay, the output is there. This is all you need. Here's what you see. This is the specification of the UI of a Docker interface. This Docker module would look like this on the web. And this is what it looks in our software. So the UI is rendered automatically based on this one. And you see it has the same elements. This is basically summarizing what I just said. We use it for customized solutions. In order to provide additional functions that we are not integrating in our main software for specific customers. And last but not least, what about our image format? To again rephrase the standard format approach, we have an open image data format. This is also important. From my opinion, it doesn't make sense to have something that only can be read by our software. So our CZI, Carl Zeiss image format, is open source. We have our own GitHub page for it. You can download the libraries. We have interfaces to .NET. We have interfaces to C++. And there are already wrappers from Python so that every data scientist doing machine learning can easily read our images. Because we want people to use our image format, because in the end, that's good for us. If our image format is the one that is easy to process, this will pay off, I'm convinced. Let's see. So try it out. And here again, same concept, still internal, but will be probably open source, reading and writing from Python. We decided it's worth creating an own open source Python library that we as Zeiss maintain even if it's free to use for the whole community. It also makes sense on those conferences. It's always a nice starting point for discussions. And last but not least, coming to an end, this is the summary slides of our machine learning landscape with all the main components. I think I mainly focused about our machine learning stack, those internal sources that are super important, Prisma Learn, CSET model, whatsoever. And then this is basically what we have. So we have the cloud solutions, we have our desktop software in the middle, we have our processing services, local or remote. We are open to academia, and obviously here support for multiple GUs. Yeah, this is obviously in the end the performance topic. Yeah, sorry for making it a bit fast at the end, but obviously keeping time is important. So at the very end, I just scroll through so you have an impression. Is it all theory or what is he talking about? Those are the typical things we do with machine learning. It's always the original image versus the segmentation afterwards. So you see here Drosophila, neurons, some living cells, whatsoever. Here it's an example. And here are more examples from industry. It's about alloys, minerals, corrosion stuff, inspecting materials. But it's always a segment. Okay, last but not least, if you're interested, here are some links. Our GitHub pages, okay, appear. I showed you the software, is a trial versions are available. Try it out. And yeah, happy about feedback about our Python libraries. If you like it or if you don't like it, you can make PRs if you want. So improve it if you feel it's worth it. And with that, I'm done here. So thanks for listening, and thanks again, Sven, for inviting.
Okay, thank you, Sebastian. We definitely have 5 minutes at least for questions. And we're also inviting questions from Slack and so on. Okay, so Sebastian, when I saw this presentation, you started by saying something like ZEISS is trying to really pivot, to do the pivot to become a digital company. And seeing what you presented makes me feel very confident, I would say, for your mission. It looks like you're on a good track here. It's impressive. When you're doing the switch to a digital company, you have one advantage, I would say. And also when you're offering a machine learning platform, because many people, you have Google, you have Amazon and so on, they all offer machine learning platforms. But you have a very special advantage, which is the vast domain knowledge that ZEISS has in terms of microscopy. But once you are really a digital company and all these workflows seem to work well, you're completely open to much more use cases, aren't you?
That is true. So, I mean, ZEISS is a kind of an old company that is always impressing, especially if you are in the States, because I think this year we have even our 175th anniversary. And you are right, we have a large customer base that has microscopes and is producing images. This is like, you know, data, the new bacon kind of approach. So the first ones they are talking to is us. This is why it makes sense. But I agree. And I think one thing we will go to, or we will do and do more and more with our cloud platform, this, at least from my perspective, most likely will become a platform where other people can offer their own solutions as well for microscopy. So it's not always us creating the solutions, but maybe it's some kind of a solution app store for some parts of industry where people that have a nice processing tool, a machine learning solution, can basically offer it to the customers they do not have, but we do. But let's see. Okay, this is the idea. We're working on it. Sorry. Let's see if it works. I would say I'm slightly optimistic that this will work out. I think we have the right infrastructure in place.
Yeah, thanks. We have one question from Slack.
Yeah, Emilia asks, how big is the team working on Appear, and how much time did it take for the product to be deployed to production?
Well, the complete team, there are basically two teams. One is doing the vet platform. I would estimate 6 or 7 people, same size for the Appear machine learning team, but they work really together with our team. So on the machine learning side, I would say we have twice the size. So 10, 12 people working on the machine learning stuff and maybe 6, 7 on the web platform. from the initial phase to the first deployment, this took quite long. And as I mentioned now, to release a new version is basically, they do it every 2 weeks. So it's highly automated and it's not every day like big web platforms do. We are still a company and, you know, but that's, yeah. So it's getting faster and faster.
All right, one other question from the audience.
I wonder, there are heaps of image formats already. Mm-hmm. Why do you need an extra one, which you promote? So
it's not an extra one because it has been there for many, many, many years. It's rather that most of the other formats came after that. So, but good question. The thing is, the problem is not so much reading images. We need something that keeps up with the speed of image acquisition. And most of the existing formats don't. So this is why we developed CZI, which is basically very closely related to other techniques that are already there, but optimized for high-speed image acquisition. And our idea is that as long as we have open and standard interfaces, free to read our CZI for everybody, nobody should so much care about how is it stored internally. In the end, it's a compromise. There are some people saying, why isn't there one image format for everybody? It's just not doable so far. Because in the end, every initiative that starts with let's make the new standard, in the end you have not 10 standards, you have 11. That's my experience. But let's see.
All right, another question from the audience.
Hello, thanks for the great talk. I have one question. At ZEISS, you have a large base of images probably from mm-hmm. your microscopes and everything, which makes it really easy for you or to provide your customers pre-trained models for your microscopes. What is your experience? How well does this pre-training at ZEISS microscopes transfer to microscopes from other producers?
Now we start talking. So that is obviously a very interesting topic. And yes, we have a lot of images. Unfortunately, that doesn't automatically mean we have a lot of labeled images. That's the first thing. So, and to come to your question, how well this network would work from an image from a different microscope highly depend on the type of microscope we are talking. For many standard microscopes, also our networks were trained on our own images, but also images that are publicly available that are already recorded with other microscopes as well. And for most methods, fluorescent stained living cell image on a normal microscope, here I'm honest, also other companies have good microscopes, they look really similar. So there it really works, but then we have some specific machines and here it's tricky and there we do not, we would never claim this works for everything. It's more to get started. In the end, as you all know, even over time, you have to retrain networks. And in the end, this comes down to having the right infrastructure to allow retraining at a fast pace. So mixed results with images from somewhere else, I would say.
And one last quick question from Slack.
Yeah, Florian would like to know, how is the data shared between the Docker containers and especially big data?
So as I said, this appear thing is based on Azure. So basically they are stored on so-called block storages. So the Docker container always knows where the data is stored and then can read it and write it. And then the container is basically finished. It will shut down and the next container is doing the same. So they are stored in the cloud. That's basically it. So nothing fancy.
All right. Thank you very much, Sebastian.
Okay. Was a pleasure.
And that's the end of that first session then. Thanks.